Hello everyone, this is going to be hopefully short and as short as possible introductory video on how to play Age of Wonders 3. This is the current game version and this is the installed DLC, Eternal Realms. There is another DLC which I didn't get yet. It has an extra race and a few extra things, but it's not crucial for understanding and enjoying the mechanics of the game and enjoying the game. I'm going to start a new random map because this is the most replayable feature of the game, and of course even more replayable would be the online multiplayer. But online multiplayer is not exactly my cup of tea. Just a few words about it. It features simultaneous turn-based, so it involves quick reactions, and also in the interest of saving time, all battles with neutral armies, independents, whatever, are left to the auto combat, which in my opinion does away with one of the best features of the game. It's a tactical battle phase, which is one of the most advanced I have encountered in these types of games. For the type of game, if you lived in a hole and never heard of Age of Wonders, I'll say closest it would come to mind would be Heroes of Might and Magic, perhaps the fourth version, where heroes were actually playable units, and they were actually took part on combat, but also with a heavy mix of empire building. I would go Civilization, but that's stretching. It doesn't have many elements common with Civilization. I played Civilization 5 a lot, as you would know if you were following this channel. Okay, new random map, mostly default settings. This is the maximum difficulty setting, which allows, that's one of the similarities with Civilization 5. It allows, and probably most of the games of this nature, allows the AIs to cheat and receive lots of extra resources and whatnot. Four players on a medium-sized map. Land map, there could be islands, more water, makes certain unit types more relevant, and perhaps even races normal game flow. There's a lot of customization here. If there's gonna be underground surface, again, common element with Hero series. Starting town, size, units, you want to start with big army, with poor army. Starting distance from probably the other players, amount of roads on the map. Now most of the units on the map, the independents guarding objects of interest, let's call them, are static. I remember there was an option in Heroes 4 where the guards of certain of points of interest were kind of patrolling, randomly moving around, and you could get attacked if you were not careful or you were not using scouts. But in this game, those type of units are fixed and there's no option to make them mobile. But there are also some structures that spawn roaming units, and those units make your life difficult. they will capture, well, they will ambush and kill all your poorly defended units moving around the map. And also, they will capture your undefended structures and even worse cities. You wouldn't think this to be too bad, but from my experience with the game, the AI cheats very heavily with those. It has perfect information. Your units don't have a lot of vision. There's a fog of the war mechanic, we'll get to it. So you're kind of navigating, air quotes, scouting blind, but these guys will hone on to your vulnerable units and quickly deal with them if you're not careful. And there's not much you can do about it. Mount of Treasures, that's something to encourage scouting even more. You're gonna get risk. The bandits and the dragons. Yes, there's roaming dragons and undead and whatever, just to find some little bits of resources. Amount of cities, amount of dwellings. There's a different cities have a population and can grow to different stages. Dwellings, on the other hand, also can have certain, depending on the dwelling type, certain unit producing buildings, but they don't have population, and they don't have development stages. Cities, once they hit different development stages, they will generate some more resources by default, and they will extend their domain. We'll get back to this once I'm actually in the game. Resource structure is what you would expect: mines, production, resource generators. Visit structures, this would be like stat boosters, temporary or one time. Whatever treasure structures, these are dungeons. If I remember the name of the game correctly, Warlords. I might be wrong. Warlords 3. I might be totally wrong here. There are some locations on the map where you can enter, fight some enemies, and get some one-time bonus, be it extra units, resources, whatever. Geography, yeah, you can play with geography. You can tweak it in favor of your preferred style of play, race, whatever combination. And here are the amount of players, of course, the AI's difficulty level. I let them be randomized. Turn timer, this is useful for multiplayer, so you know, can set short one, and so the game actually finishes in before the end of time. Here you can choose simultaneous turns. I don't like this feature, I prefer classic turns. Customized leaders, tactical combat mode. Here you can, in a multiplayer game, you can force this to auto resolve against the AI. Always auto combat, and that's it. You know the other player won't cheat. He won't be able to anyway if you set a short enough timer. And advanced rules. What else? Normal game speed, I think. Yeah, research costs, city growth, stuff like that. Resources, skills. How many skills, air quotes, technologies you start with? This is something that was probably added later. I don't think it had it in the beginning. Again, I envision this as good for multiplayer, but a cheat in single player. What it does is It casts a very powerful end game spell ability on all your heroes for free or every battle. So it really lowers the difficulty settings. It's abusable as hell. But in a multiplayer game, it has its place. I mean, you play for, I don't know, 3 hours, and AI will lose one of your heroes in auto combat. You have no control of, and that's it. All that building up was wasted on something you have no control of over. But in single player, it's just too much. Resurgence, you can get it with different in different forms, so better put from different sources. Depending on hero class, leader class, but it's very powerful. It's extremely powerful, and it's end game, and has major impact if you receive such extremely powerful ability in the beginning of the game from the start at no cost. Defender strength, yeah, you can up the difficulty here a lot. That would change the flow of the game. I've yet to try harder than normal, but even with the difficulty setting, this is like ramping up way more. Cosmic happenings, again, this is like I recall those from Master of Orion settings, a series. I don't know, space dragon coming and terrorizing citizens of some poor system and stuff like that. Various bonuses and penalties for a limited number of turns. Number of heroes on top of your civilization defining leader, which is actually a hero. You get some extra heroes to help out. This is the maximum number for per faction. You can tweak this, and also the maximum number 20. It's plenty. I don't think I've had a hero above rank 11, level 11. So 20, it's plenty. But you can tweak this. Map exploration. Yeah, you can. There is also the factor of fog of the war that you cannot turn off, but you can have the map already explored. It doesn't help you because of some very dubious mechanics. Everything in fog of the war, you cannot click on any tile to get information about terrain of that tile. It's explored, but being in the fog of the war, you don't know. Maybe someone went there and casted some terraformation spell in. Your information could be wrong, so it's not going to tell you. Also about structures, nothing. Well, they could be explored. Again, you can't click on a structure in Fog of the War and know what type of structure it is, and that's a bit sad. Along the mechanic of founding more cities, that's another big game changer. Random heroes. You start with your leader, and then some. Eventually, as your civilization, air quotes, civilization develops, more heroes will join your cause. And this is convenience setting for high-speed tactical combat. This is the animations of units. After a while, of course, you're gonna set this to maximum speed because you're just watching the same thing over and over again. They get repetitive. Okay, and with that said, I can launch the map generator. Generate a new map. No, first I must pick off. These are the default heroes, or you can customize one from the start. You get to pick race, class. As you see, class. It's above race. It's not an accident. Class defines more of what's going to happen in a game, how it's going to play, the skills you're going to have access to, the units you're going to have access to, eventually the gameplay type. They play very differently. They offer very different experience types. The classes, the race is like adds a few extra colors, but it's way less influenced than what the class does. And on top of that, you've got class, race, and the three. I wouldn't call those skills, because let's call those specializations. Let's go in and go for one. So races, classes. There's not a lot of them currently in the game. Warlord, rogue, sorcerer, summoner, basically necromancer. Yeah, dreadnought. This one is able to build all sorts of machinery, and it's good at repairing and maintaining them. Archdruid summons all sorts of animals and worse. It's very similar to the sorcerer in many regards. Theocrat, this one's the religious zealot with focused on durability and heals. It's very tough. Probably the most played race in multiplayer, but I'm not an authority on that. It's probably a bit overpowered. It's very powerful from the start. And Warlord, this one's not very played in multiplayer, because its power curve is somewhat lacking in the beginning of the game. It has a stronger end game, but in a multiplayer game, which is played on small dual maps, usually you're gonna get killed way sooner than that, unless you're a god of Age of Wonders. Races, we have stock humans everywhere. Elves, good archeries. I'm going to go over the classes and the races again in the game. It has a pretty good encyclopedia that's got more information than here on creation, on leader creation. And there are a few, look, they are called specializations. You have three slots: air, the elemental ones. You can go adept and then master. You need to spend two slots for that. You have maximum. You have three specialization slots. Let's say I want to go fire master. You need to go adept fire. This unlocks master of fire, and this leaves another spot for something else. On top of the elemental ones, there's expander, which allows faster empire expansion. Not really. Explorer, which also helps a lot in combat. You wouldn't be able to say, because here on hero customization, it only shows one of the most basic bonuses you get from picking it. You'll have it enabled at the beginning of the game, but as the game unlocks, they actually have a sort of technology tech tree, and you can research extra abilities for each one. It's hard to make an informed choices here. You need meta knowledge. What actual tech tree you choose by picking those. And there are some choices related to alignment, good, evil, and neutral. Neutral being the harder to maintain in this game. And that's basically it. Class, big factor. Race, less important, but there are some synergies between that work better between various class and race combos. and of course the three specializations, which are not that many to choose from. The other DLC adds, I believe, one or two more specializations. One, it's, I think, something like guerrilla warrior, which allows you to flee combats and with the movement points and come back. It's, maybe it's called Partisan. And the other, it's Wild Magic or something. It doesn't show here because I don't have the DLC. Okay, I'm going to go back and choose my pre-made character, which I'm going to use for the upcoming let's play. It's a Warlord work. They have works have some synergies, decent synergies with Warlord special units. One, like in case of Berserker, the arguably the Tigran, which is another race, Berserker, it's better. Also the Warbreed, that's another special unit. The Warbreed, it's gets special bonuses. I think it has Tireless or Guard Break or something. Also the Manticore Rider, which is the tier 4 unit. Their units are split roughly in tiers of power, effectivity. Tier 1, Tier 2, Tier 3, and Tier 4. Tier 4 units are class specific, and some classes don't even have Tier 4 units. I think the Rogue doesn't have, but their Tier 3 unit is very, very strong. Versus physical damage, though. It's okay, let's leave it at that. And I choose these three specializations for him: Explorer, Keeper of the Peace. This is the good alignment, gets some extra diplomatic relation with independent cities, and Keeper of the Peace Master. Those are the basic bonuses you get. Like I said, there's the tech tree behind all of this, enabled by these picks, which I'm going to get to more in the actual Orc Warlord let's play, but for now just to go with the game mechanics. So now we actually generate the map. Yes, I could pause the video if this takes any longer, but no. Okay. And finally, after all this introductory blabber, we finally are in the actual game. That's usually what you'll get at the start of a game with mostly default settings. Like I said, you could tweak this to be way stronger, higher tier defenders, monsters. Or you have weaker armies, your starting city would be even lower, like an outpost or something. And now with all these elements here, we can start talking about the game. Where do we start? The purpose of the game is to kill your enemies. Probably it's listed here somewhere. Defeat all rival empires. Allied victory, like I said, it was checked there. And with the lose game condition is lose your leader and your throne city, which incidentally is the only city you start with. But if you are to pursue the victory goal, there is only one way, and that is to achieve a very small scroll indicator in this In this tab, that lists the amount of cities you have. The more, the better. This is the game research system, and it features three types of, let's call them skills, technologies. Note the graphic behind each of them. This one is called the Empire Bonus or something, right? Empire Upgrade. Those are the ones I start with because of my particular hero specialization. And they are somewhat randomized. You get some of them you get all the time, like Mediator and Bearer of Light, because you've read them in character creation. The spell, however, could be random. This is also automated. You always get it. The combat skill spells, however, are somewhat randomized from the pool of spells available to your particular class combination choice. Those are strategic spells. So there are global strategic spells. They have this graphic around them. There are combat spells. Those you can only cast during combat. And those are, how should I say, passive empire-wide effects, empire upgrades. And you get to choose a maximum, and this is randomized. You don't get to see the tech tree like in Civilization 5. And what is worse, they're somewhat randomized. Some of them are fixed, the position here, this extra casting point skill. It's always going to be here. The mobility thing, it's always going to be here. Basic warfare, seafaring, advanced seafaring, and advanced logistics. But there's no basic logistics, but I think that's what it's called. It's always going to be here, and also this class-specific unit upgrade line, which, if you look here, doesn't look like it. It's a class-specific unit production technology, and it isn't. It is a strategic spell. But it gates, it unlocks if you... I can't move the mouse because it will... It's an overlay. It unlocks the research to produce Berserker, and the research in Berserker will unlock the next unit. And that's how it works. The rest of the technologies here are... technology skills are somewhat randomized based on what's available. I think you can find online the whole line, but you can't, you're not guaranteed to get like this Authority of the Sword. You could get one of the other spells. It's a random in the beginning of the game from the spells your character can get. It's somewhat randomized. Okay, that's the research, the actual skills. You get to pick one. And this is the amount of knowledge it takes to research it. My empire is outputting currently 20 knowledge. This technology, particular technology, costs 60, so ergo it will take me 3 turns to unlock this upgrade technology, whatever. How do I get more knowledge, you ask? Knowledge doesn't scale or... should I say, it scales kind of somewhat linearly with the number of cities you have. That's one of the main reasons why you need to acquire a large number of cities to maintain a competitive advantage in this type of game. The amount of knowledge you can output out of a single city, it's limited. I mean, there are some more advanced structures that can help. There are some these resource sites on the map that can help your city's output. I don't have any in this particular city. In this case, it's random. It could be. I have gold generator and I have mana node mana generator. This one is a production generator and it's guarded. In order to access its bonus, to add it to my city, I need to first to remove the defenders and then to get my city border domain, the game calls it domain, to encompass it. And there's a few ways to achieve that. There are some buildings inside the city that increase domain border. I think stone walls will increase your domain border, and observatory, and maybe there's one more. It's a blade game, I might be wrong. There's also a this is specific to the warlord class, Authority of the Sword. It's if you look around it, it's a strategic spell, global spell, strategic spell. It costs 40 mana and 40 casting points. We'll get to that. To activate, it activates on a city and it increases its domain radius. And also, organically, cities have various stages of development. It shows here. Here, it will take at the current rate of population growth. It will reach the next stage. It will grow from village to let's see what it will go to. City growth. City growth. So the newly freshly settled city will start with a 100 population. It will be called an outpost, and with, it's shame it doesn't show here, but it will produce by default a small amount of gold and production, and the village gives a bit more gold and a bit more production, and once it goes to 6,000 population, it will produce even more gold and production, base gold and production, and so on. If you want to relate this to Civilization 5, only the center city tile has these bonuses, and they are unlocked with each stage of development. Also, once with each extra stage of development, the city gains one extra domain tile ring, to call it so. And also, these tiles that don't have a specific resource, don't add anything. Actually, they kind of do. There's the morale, city morale mechanic, and there's a few modifiers here. One of it comes, it's a, like a generic empire modifier. If you win battles, you recruit heroes, you get some bonuses that apply to all your cities. Then there's the race modifier. That comes for your leader relation with a particular race in game. So let's say you play orcs and you raise or migrate a few most of the human cities you met, you're gonna have and you settle a lot of orc cities, you're gonna have great relation with the orcs, and they're going to be happy with you. But if you were to acquire a human city, they're going to be very, they're going to hate you. That's the race happiness modifier. Also, local city happiness modifiers. Those can be like here, if I have the leader in a city, it will add happiness. If there's some city improvements, buildings that add happiness to that particular city, and there is there are terrain, preferred terrain. If the race, so this is orc village, orcs love a particular type of terrain and climate. If you put let's say draconians, which are have dragon blood and they spit fire, if you put them in arctic area, they're not going to be very happy. You're going to have, and it's summed for each tile if they like it or they don't like it. So on a very big city, you can add a lot of happiness or unhappiness if you don't match your race of that particular city with their preferred climate and geography, whatever. There's usually two things that vary from tile to tile. There are some later in the game. There are some spells that can help with terraforming. Depending again on your specializations and class options, you'll be able to do some that's black and white, or populous, maybe populous type of game mechanic, terraforming for your race. Let's not call it need, let's call it preference. Back to the knowledge. Like I said, in one city, the amount of knowledge you can output from a single city, it's limited, and maxing it requires a lot of expenses. Like I said, advanced buildings cost a lot of resources, and it's not optimal to possible to get them early. You can't the concept of tall cities doesn't apply to this game. If you want competitive knowledge tech pace, you need to acquire multiple cities. That's one of the main reasons why you need to expand, conquer, found, buy, through diplomacy, whatever means. You need the cities, and you need to keep expanding. That's one of the reasons. But is like I said, it could be the only one. It will be enough. If you don't have enough knowledge, enough cities, you're gonna be behind. You won't be able to unlock your high level units, class units, or spells, or abilities, or whatever, and you're gonna be easily squashed like a bug. staying small, it's equals death. That's the main goal of this game, is to expand and acquire as many cities as possible. There is no, how should I call it? Downsides, but mechanics like limiting mechanics like there are in Civilization 5, like extra science penalty for having more cities, extra city, or which is really silly, but I don't know, viable gameplay mechanic, or the penalty, diplomatic penalties. You are expanding too fast. Well, that sort of maybe I'm not so certain how diplomacy works in this game. It's not one of its strong points anyway. But yeah, I've been warned at some points by various leaders, AI leaders, please stop expanding by near my borders, and eventually even get declared war, but not specifically motivated by that. He will just maybe it's a factor, probably is a factor, but it's not clear to me. The other reason to acquire multiple cities is another way to get the benefit of resource structures on the map. Is after clearing them, you can also project domain by building forts. Forts are built by some special units, worker units, workers, but they look very different than the ones from Civilization 5. The workers can build the roads just like in Civilization, and they also can build the forts, and forts can project a small domain area and thus give those global resources to your empire pool. Because gold, as expected, is a global resource. It doesn't matter where you're collecting or in which city you're collecting it or how you get it. There are other ways to get gold, like selling buildings, artifacts, cutting trees. Some units can make gold of that. In the underground, you can tunnel through or dig through various tiles, and you also generate small amounts of gold. Whatever, how you acquire it, or diplomacy. I've had an allied AI gift me some gold. Whatever the source, it pulls into your one treasury. There is no individual city gold treasury. Same for mana. Regardless of the source, it's all collected in one single pool, mana pool, to spend as you see fit. Same for knowledge. Casting population is another resource, and this one obviously local for cities. Once you achieve enough population, you for the next grow level, you will automatically the city will grow to maybe its next stage of development. That's population. And another local resource is casting points. You can have tons of mana, but each of your heroes can only cast a small amount of I can use a small amount of mana per turn. The Empire leader, it's a bit different. He can, on top of the spells he can cast in battle, like the other heroes, he can also use spells global. The global spells only the leader can cast the global spells. And they all use, they both use the same limited casting points, but this is specific to the leader. And it's there are some technologies that increase that, and there are some resources on the map that increase this for the leader or for all heroes, specific type of heroes, whatever. But important is they are local to local, air quotes. Individual for each hero. They're not global resource. You can spend as you see fit anywhere. Back to the need for expansion. Okay, you understand. You want knowledge. You somehow you acquire a large number of cities. But then what happens? The roaming monsters and the other players, human players, will punish you the first time you get. But even the AI will wanna capture their city, those cities, take them from you, especially if they are poorly defended. So, and you really can't afford to leave like anything untied, anything undefended in this game. It's risky. You can deal with the roaming armies generators on the map, providing you have good scouting game and kill those structures. Once you clear them, they will stop generating units. But, and you could say something like, this is in the corner of the map, I cleared this, there's no more unit generator. Anything that will threaten this city will have to go through, like through here or through here. I can leave the city undefended and save on upkeep costs. Buildings in city don't have upkeep cost like in Civilization 5, but all units do have upkeep cost, and it adds up. You can't do that because of the newly added feature, let's call the world events, the cosmic events. I could say something like, it's gonna rain frogs. It's gonna rain rain orcs next turn, and those raining orcs are gonna find your undefended city and sack it. So really, you need to have at the very least one turn to two turns away some kind of intervention force to recapture your city if you don't if you want to save a bit of upkeep costs. Okay, you need this huge army to stay alive, because you're not alone on the map. There are independent armies and there are the other players. This huge army, first, you don't get it. It doesn't grow on trees. You must pay for it. Maybe you get some units by clearing some encampments. You can get units, but most of the units you're gonna manufacture. But this is entirely wrong way of saying it. You actually pay for every unit you build inside your cities. See, they don't have a production cost. It's listed there. They have gold cost, and the most advanced ones have gold and mana resource cost. You pay for everything. You want to build a thousand, I don't know, dragons. You must pay for all 1,000 dragons, and it doesn't end there. Then every turn you must pay their upkeep, which is quite high for tier 4 units. At any given time, your empire, there's only a limited number of size of army your empire can support based on your gold income. Also, you probably, if you have multiple cities, you want to develop them at least to some stages. And let's go back to the city again. Buildings again. There is no alternative like it's in Civilization 5, city production to produce units or gold. Call them hammers. There is no hammer resource in this game. There's only gold and mana. You pay for absolutely everything. Buildings. You have, I don't know, 10 cities, and you want to build, let's say you want to build a war hall to enable you to build horses, mounted units. You want to build war hall in all your 10 cities. Multiply this 175 gold cost by 10. Just to get Warhol on all those 10 cities next turn. How much gold does that leave for you to pay your troops? And how much gold does that leave to build military units in other cities? Is that is the economy of this game. Gold, for Warlord, gold is the more limiting factor. Though at some stages in the game, mana can also be more advanced buildings and units. For other classes, this is somewhat split between gold and mana. So you need bigger number. Excuse me. big number of cities to output. Lots of knowledge to keep pace with the other players, so not to be out gunned. They will have more advanced units and abilities and spells. Then you'll need tons of resources, gold and mana, to output a huge army big enough to defend all of that territory, and also to allow you in the same time to keep developing various cities, and also if possible to keep building more units, more and more units. Like you can see at this stage in the game, my gold input is extremely limited, and if I were to be gifted I don't know, a dragon or something, I would have to fire all the other units just to be able to keep it, just to pay its salary or something. Once you run out of gold, the units become unhappy and eventually desert if you don't have spells to make them your slaves and never leave you. But joke aside, this is again, big territory will ensure you get more resources, but in the same time, it will cost you a lot more resources to build the army, need to protect it, and to maintain that army. It's a bit of a catch 22. Also, at any given point, you will, at any point in the game, you will not have resources. Maybe when you like 99% you won the map, the game, you will have enough resource output to improve all your cities and build units from multiple cities. That typically, if the game is not designed that way, the economy, you'll never have the economy to develop multiple cities in the same time and build armies in from multiple cities. It's an extreme economic effort to be able to do that. And it will be a tough choice between do I build this building here and this building there, or do I have enough resources left to build perhaps another tier 3 unit here? Or if I want to build dragons, I probably need to put all my entire 20 city build empire on hold. No more upgrades for anyone in the empire. Stop other unit building just to be able to afford to get those dragons, expensive tier 4 units. This is a big part of the game. You get what can help you. Scouting can help. There are some various free resources scattered on the map. Of course, you can tick that on the map generation. You saw the settings. There are always a few free piles in the immediate vicinity of your city. I have vision to see them because I one of them specialization of my leader, which is just a special hero, basically. It's a bit more special hero because he also handle empire casting points and the technologies of the empire. But other than that, in battle, it's functionally just functions the same as all the other heroes, except he cannot die. He will return. If he falls in battle, he will return 2 turns later and doesn't have a resurgence. There are always some free piles of gold resources, this is mana, around your city, which you should grab as soon as possible. I can see them because one of the specialization of this hero is explorer, and it adds an extra tile of vision to my domain, and that's why I can see them. Otherwise, I would need to move units. I think I spoke for the moment enough about the goal, the purpose of the game, the need to expand, to tech fast, and to acquire the resources to maintain the army required to protect it all. Let's talk about a bit about hero leader class and about races. So let's go. Class F1 brings up the in-game encyclopedia. It's a shame you cannot access this online. There are some the wiki has similar the amount of information. It's presented in a different way, but in certain ways it has more information. about certain aspects, but still, this would be a great resource to be if it were made available offline. Sadly, not offline, off game, online, it's not available. So, class, those are the currently the hero classes in this game. Archdruid, compared to the other heroes, is gonna have a bit more extra HP, hit points at the creation, and extra vision, and this is spell resistance, and we'll get to damage applying mechanics, and we'll go to those stats, or maybe I should go to, let's go to the stats first, because otherwise this doesn't make sense. So let's choose a particular unit. It doesn't have to be a hero. It's a work Black Knight. There's a lot of information in this window. Tier of the unit. Like I said, units are ordered in or classified in according to their magnitude of power, so to speak, roughly in tiers. Tier 1, which are the weakest units, then tier 2, then tier 3, and the ultimate tier is tier 4. Must keep in mind, I mean, this type of games, it doesn't mean all the tier 4 units or within the tier the power is the same, or that there aren't particular synergies between tiers, or that tier 1 units cannot kill tier 4 units. They can, but it's just harder. Tier 4 units have, generally speaking, have more hit points and more defense and resistance. So let's continue. This is the name of the unit. This is the tier. This is the upkeep cost. It can be modified by some abilities. You can get them to be to pay less for them. Like I said, this upkeep number here is on top of the build cost, because you need to pay to build them. There's also the upkeep cost, an extra limiting factor on how big an army your any particular empire can sustain at a particular moment. Bigger empire with more resource generation can afford a bigger army. Okay, statistics. Hit points, clear for everyone that ever played the game. Reach zero, it dies. You can heal it. It regenerates at the end of the turn, naturally regenerates 6 points. Heroes can help with that with various abilities and items. They can make most units regenerate 6 points, hit points per turn. I think they're Draconians. They regenerate faster. Goblins regenerate faster in a particular terrain type. They like in swamps, they will regenerate faster. Undead and machines, they don't regenerate at all, as expected. Movement points, that pertains to movement on the strategic map and in combat. I will go into movement in more detail a bit later. Basically, each tile, depending on the terrain type, it has a different movement cost, and you can have how should I call it, different perks that can help with reduce the penalties or eliminate for particular terrain types. For example, as expected, as you would expect, dwarves. All units can move on top of most mountains, but just a quick check. See, for each tile, you get to see the climate and the terrain type. It's a tropical climate, and the terrain is barren, and barons have a base move cost of 4 movement points. So if I were to move a unit into this tile, it would cost me 4 movement points to move that walking unit into that tile. Moving from here to here, because this tile costs 4, it will cost me 4 movement points, which will get reduced from the 36 the unit has. If I were to move from any tile into this mountain tile, this one costs 14 movement costs, so obviously way harder to move over mountains. But as expected, the dwarves, for example, have a mountaineering perk, which reduces this penalty a lot. So it makes movement through, it reduces it to, I believe, 6 through mountains. Also, dense vegetation, it will slow most units' movement unless you remove it and put a road in its place, or you are have the forestry perk, which as you'd expect, would allow you your units to move faster through dense vegetation and forest tiles. Again, as expected, elves have elf units have forestry, all of them. But you can get it on heroes level up choices. Back to the unit stats. That's basically movement. Not all units are walkers. This game also has floating and flying units. Flying units obviously will not care much about terrain penalty, though even they move a bit slower over mountains. I think there's 5 tiles. 5 movement points per mountain tile for flyers. Thing we can check like this. Flying, Ming, flying unit. It's able to fly. Any type of terrain, movement cost of 3. So even if here it says 4 move cost, flying units will move at cost 3. The other, the walkers will also move at cost 3 only if there's a road or a bridge on that tile. The bridges are, yeah, it showed me the underneath water tile cost. It's 4 if I were to move on the water, because sea creatures and units that have swimming can move on water. Lots of Jesus is moving around on this in this game. But also the bridge can be walked upon. It can only be one tile long. All the bridges in this game, you can build them with your builders. But where I was going to is roads have a base cost of 3. Flyers don't care, they move for 3 anywhere except mountains. They move they pay 5 movement coins for mountain. Roads will remove forest, dense vegetation, they will remove it where it, if it already on the tile, and the movement cost for road by default is 3 movement costs. If you research basic seafaring and advanced seafaring, as you would not expect and would have no reason to expect it, after basic seafaring and advanced seafaring, the third technology allows walker and floating units to move faster on road. It lowers to only 2 movement points cost per tile. So in the end game, walker units will move faster on the road than flyers can fly. It still doesn't mean they'll be the fastest to reach a particular destination, because in this game you cannot you can never build the roads over mountains, so your walkers will probably need to move around, while the flyers can still fly pretty fast on top of mountains or other obstacles. That was a long parenthesis, and also movement Back to the unit statistics, the move points are also relevant to the tactical combat. We'll get back to them there. Defense, as you'd expect, physical damage from both melee and ranged attacks. When I get to combat, we'll get more into it, how it's damage it's calculated. And the resistance, again, it's for resisting various spell effects, and also it's used for when calculating all non-physical damage inflicted on this unit. Melee strike, this is the base damage for melee attacks. We'll get later to the number of strikes. Warcry, this is specific to orcs. They can increase their melee damage for a turn with cooldown. Walking, yeah, most units are walkers in this game. The walking undead. Polearm, these are stuff, not obviously not units get the same stats. I will tell you the race of the units, and with the race there come inherits from the race different modifiers. Again, victory rush, and it even lists the source of the perk here. All orcs get victory rush, so after each combat they will, if alive, obviously they will heal 10 hit points, which is a very strong perk, which allows the unit to start turn very almost dead, and if you carry it, successfully carry it through 3-4 fights, it will heal like 40 hit points. Keep in mind, enter regeneration by default is only 6, so you can see why this can how this can be a very strong perk, and that works good. Mounted obviously has benefits and drawbacks. One benefit is there is, for example, warlord class technology that increases the amount of hit points mounted units get. It's very strong. Lots of mounted units will benefit for extra hit points. Also, all heroes are mounted units, so it increases the hit points of all heroes. But there's also some unit types that get bonuses versus mounted, bonus damage versus mounted and flying units. So yeah, benefits and drawbacks as expected. Armored means even if this armor score here, it's high. Higher than compared to other, let's say, tier 2 cavalry units that are unarmored, this armor can be negated by some perks. So it's situational, it's a situational bonus. Also, I think another class, Dreadnought, can make armored units. It has even better bonuses for armored units. So these are the main stats of a unit anyway: hit points, movement points, defense, resistance, and also if it can, if it has a range attack, it will be listed here. Let's check out the units I started with. I didn't get any range unit. Well, this guy can throw javelin. So this is a ranged attack. Most range attacks in this game have listed range medium. That's 6 tiles in combat. We'll get to it again more specifically when we'll go into the tactical combat. You see how this is different from the other unit. It's tier 1. It's cheaper to maintain. It's also cheaper to build. Less hit points, less defense, less resistance. As you would expect, is not tier 2, it's tier 1. Less damage because of work. This the same things inherited, like victory rush and heal after battles. Unlike those cavalry, they have shields, which again it's a situational armor bonus, defense bonus, physical defense bonus. Unlike the horses, they're not mounted units, those are irregulars. Again, they can get some bonuses that apply for or against particular types of units. You can get buildings that get give extra experience. Well, I didn't went on there yet. To particular, say to infantry or to mounted or to pikemen or to archers, and big unit types or to irregulars. This one also have a nice ability. It's called sprint. You can see here what it does. It allows you to sprint in combat once per it has cooldown. Very nice. Allows you to dodge attacks of opportunity. Again, we'll see this in more detail once I do combat. Unit experience. This is different from. Well, it's different from heroes. is it though? Yes, there was no concept of unit experience in heroes. No. Yeah, most of them didn't. Here, units can gain experience by doing taking various actions in combat. I think attacking. Big bonus for killing units, depending on the unit tier. So if you kill a tier 4 unit, you'll get a lot of experience. Maybe casting spells or whatever. I don't think getting hit grants experience. And once certain amounts of thresholds, amounts of experience are acquired, various bonuses are granted. These bonuses are differ from unit to unit. So these spearmans at elite level will get I don't know, a bit more damage, bit more defense, more hit points, and those are cumulative bonuses. So elite spearman compared to this recruit will have 1, 2, 3, 4 extra melee damage, two extra melee damage and two extra range strength. I need to pay attention. 2, 4, 8, that's 6. That's 10 extra hit points and 2 extra defense compared to the recruit version. And also another special ability, armor piercing. Let's check another unit. This is a tier 3 one. Again, even more hit points, more defense resistance, obviously hits harder, and a lot of great abilities, tireless. This is a very powerful ability, guard breaker, another very exceptionally powerful ability. We'll get to those in combat. Infantry grants wall climbing. This is comes into play in city sieges. It's relevant. Again, being an orc inherits the same bonus orcs, orcs get. I think I want enough about units. I am going to check this hero. What? It's a dreadnought. Okay, I'm gonna accept it. So let's see what a hero looks like. A hero also has the same basic stats like any other unit. It's just a bit more special that he also have this resource. It's called casting points. Like I said, it's a local for each hero. You can increase this, but unlike the leader that has Empire technologies that increase it, they have they don't have the same upgrade system like the other units, like with the medals. They have here hero upgrades, various abilities. each level up, they will get awarded 5 skill points, and you can spend those skill points to get various abilities, like this and this and this and this, and this doesn't show the great in greatest detail if you're new to the game. And you see the heroes that will offer to join you are random. You can turn them away if you don't like it. Like, necromancers usually don't work well unless you're playing necromancer leader. They don't synergize well with the living armies. But you can always check if you have a new type of leader and what you're gonna get. Let's see here. Dreadnought of hero offers to join me. What can I expect of him? Well, these are the hero the abilities you can are unlocked at level 1. Extra morale for units in battle. I like this. It's very nice. What the Dreadnought hero doesn't give, however, it's sadly its ability to heal troops in combat and at the end of the turn. Like an archdruid might, or warlord. So let's see. Look, warlord at level 1, I get access to field medic, and this makes the troops heal faster. There's also and field medic, this also stacks with fast healing. Oh, I think all heroes have it. We'll get back to this. Hero units compared to the other units have fast healing by default. They regenerate 6 hit points per turn on top of those 6 default each unit gets. And oh yeah, speaking of hero abilities, F1 hero, let's say Dreadnought, let's go back to level 1. There are 3 types of bonuses they can get. This one is squad stack upgrade. If this hero is leading a particular stack of units, they will all get this bonus. There are some there's also spells. Now this unlocks a new spell for the respective hero. Heroes only the leader has access to the spells you research on the Empire. Using research, Empire research, you can unlock various combat spells, but they're only available to the leader. They can be casted on every battle, even if the leader is not by the leader. Even if the leader is not present, it just costs double the casting points and mana if you want to do that. But the other heroes, they don't. The only way they gain new spells is by spending their skill points, level up skill points to unlock new spells. So let's go back to here. Let's say warlord, level 1 warlord. There's spells, there's individual bonuses, like overwhelm. This is a bonus that affects only the particular hero unit. Overwhelm, that hero will do more damage against spikeman, but no. Wall climbing, no, that's for the hero as well. Those are spells. Last command, defense command. Oh no, defense command, this is a stack, an army bonus. It affects all units you're commanded. Berserk, it's a spell. Heroes can spend their points to increase the amount of casting points, or to get individual bonuses for themselves, like this while climbing or overwhelm, and to or to get army bonuses like defense command that affects all units in a stack. There's some stack. What's a stack? On a tile, you can have at each time world map maximum of 6 units. You're not gonna see more, never. Always the maximum is 6 units. That's a stack. In a battle, you can have multiple stacks. I don't know, it's the maximum number of stacks. I think 3 and 3 and 1. I think it could be perhaps 7 stacks at the maximum in combat. And each stack has its leader, granting its leading bonuses to that particular stack. How the leader is chosen for a part for an individual stack that has multiple possible leaders, multiple heroes. There are some rules to that. I know that the Empire leader will always lead any stacks. So if you have a hero with a lot of army bonuses, it makes no sense to keep him with the leader in the same stack. Those bonuses won't work. He needs to lead a separate stack. When there's two different heroes, I think the one that grants more bonuses is the one picked, and if that is equal, the one with the higher level, it gets pretty strange. Hopefully, it's made easier by the fact that eventually you'll want each hero. For this type of game, medium map with 4 AI players, the meta game. You will reach a point when each hero will be leading its own stack of units. The ground to cover, you know, it will be big enough. They call this map medium, but it's in fact pretty large. You will need a lot of heroes to cover it all. So there's no problem skilling them all as army leaders. I would actually advise it, but in the other game modes, let's say a duel on a small map, you probably want by the time the decisive battle it's fought, you won't have that many stacks, so it's feasible to skill a particular hero more towards individual bonuses, just to make that particular unit better in combat, and not at leading armies, because there are not going to be multiple stacks. Enough stacks to go around on a small map. Where was I? Unit stats, heroes. They're a bit different than the other units. They have casting points. They can cast spells. They come with some spells pre-learned, random. That's the hero. That's the leader. I'm interested in this guy. I think I need to check like here. Combat spells. This girl is a girl. And as Dreadnought, they usually come with these spells. Already learn, and by spending skill points at level up, they can learn more spells. Let's go back to classes now. Now that I explained a bit on unit stats, let's go back to class. And Archdruids, yeah, now this should make a bit more sense. They have a bit more vision on a strategic map, extra hit points, and more non-physical damage resistance and resistance to spell effects. Dreadnoughts, they start with this armored trait, which, like I said, makes them more resilient to physical damage, unless some armor sundering traits are in play. Also, by default, they have more armor, so the Dreadnought hero is more resistant to physical damage. Necromancer, and also, okay, necromancers, they don't do quite as much physical damage, but they also do some elemental damage, blight, frost, and spirit, which can be problematic for units with vulnerability to those types of elements, and also problematic on flanking attacks, which boost each element type damage individually. So the more damage types you have, the more you benefit from flanking attacks. We'll get to those in more details when I reach combat. Again, he has more hit points. He heals, passively heals undead, and has this Res Corrupts skill. Rogues, again, they are a bit hardier than most heroes, and they have they're damage oriented. They have extra melee and range damage, a bit more, and also the ability to backstab, which adds even more physical damage when they hit on flanks. So this basically all flanks are, you can look at flanks as backstab attacks, only that the actual backstab ability improves that the flank damage. There's the same conditions to triggering backstab and flanking. Well, you can also flank with the ranged weapons, and backstab is probably melee only. Sorcerer, let's make certain you have a doubt. Backstab unit ability deals melee flanking attack. See, but only applies to melee. Back to no, there yet. Here, class sorcerer, they are a bit more resistant than most, and they receive extra casting points. That's what Channeler does, a tiny bit of extra casting points per turn. Theocrat heroes, they have even more resistance, and the Devote trait, again, this is bonus and a drawback, this Devote trait. Some units will do more damage, extra damage to Devote units. Some units will be healed more if they have Devote friends and stuff like that. Warlord, again, it's armored and has extra melee damage, so it's powerful. But on top of this, individual stat bonuses, each class has a list of skills. Let's see if this works. Yep. Class skills. No. This is here. The skill points achieved at level up. Let's go again. Dreadnought, level 1. Spell, army bonus. Extra casting points, spell, ability, combat ability, strategic ability. Again, strategic ability at level 5, for example, you get access to some new abilities. Wall climbing, that is a combat ability, combat ability, combat ability. Army leading ability. But what is surprisingly, what it doesn't show is specific, each class has a specific tech tree and a specific list of units. I think we can somewhat see this here, like units. If I filter for, well, let's pick a race, class. You see that they get different unit types. So the Archdruid will get hunters and shamans. The warlords will get, let's sort them by tier, scouts and monster hunters and mounted archers and berserkers and phalanxer orbit, and a lot of special units. Theocrats will get martyrs, crusaders, exalted, evangelists. Here the race class combo will have some differences. For example, let's check. Yeah, lifted throttling the exalted. This maybe the crusader. Let me check something. Draconian, martyr, crusader, exalted, evangelist. Yeah, I think this is here. So this evangelist, because they're draconians, they have ranged ability, the fireballs. But if the theocrat evangelists, the high elf ones, evangelists, they don't have a range of that. That's bits of things that can differ from on the same class unit from different race. Again, we can check that with the warlord. Let's check the warlord mounted archer. Let's check the elf version of the mounted archer. You see, he's got shots longbow that has no range damage penalty. We'll get to this in combat. It's a strong ability. It has a base damage of 11 because elves have bonus range damage. But if you were to make a work mounted archer, yeah. Less damage, and it shoots bow. It doesn't have longbow. On top of the lesser damage, it's only effective at a very short range. That's three tiles to do maximum damage, not the full six tiles the elves get. Stuff like this, the differences again. For Warlord, you can check. Tigran Berserker. This pounce ability basically adds that extra mobility. You can move him full range of movement and then pounce behind the unit and enter defensive mode. These guys eventually get tireless at elite level, so it's very powerful. Races don't get pounce. Yeah, lower berserker won't get it. He'll have Warcry, which allows him to increase damage, but you know, with cooldown. Some units don't differ that much from race to race. Of course, they'll have their race modifier. So let's go quickly to the races, perhaps. Yeah, so then let's see race. Not governments. Oh yeah, should I use those points? So what it means to be a draconian? They like particular terrains, and this affects their morale, city morale, and unit in combat morale, which are two different things. They have bonus fire protection. They're vulnerable to weaknesses. Their cities produce extra mana. Generally, cities don't produce any mana by themselves. You need to add some buildings or have mana generator in domain, in city domain. And they have the threat fast healing. These guys heal by default 12 hit points instead of 6 at the end of the turn. Goblins are they like wetlands, they dislike this, they hate that. Again, like I said, terrain affects morale, city morale, and unit morale in combat, which two different things. Bonuses. They have less HP, their units have less HP, but are resistant to blight. They are cheaper to build. Look, the settler costs less money and less population to build. So you can build a bigger army with the same amount of money, even if they're a bit weaker. They have less hit points. Population, they have a population growth bonus, which this allows you to reach expand city borders and reach and make the cities generate a bit more resources by default as they increase their tier, and also they move faster in wetlands, and also they heal faster in this is wetland foraging. They heal faster at the end of the turn if they are in this particular terrain they like. Works, they have more hit points but less resistance, so it can be very scary with when elemental attacks of multiple elemental types, like it could be three types of elemental on the one attack, and can be three up to three swings per turn or attacks per turn per combat round. Having less resistance for this, it's calculated for each swing. So like I said, a unit that does, let's say, cold fire and spirit damage in an attack and attacks three times, that's 9 extra damage from that elemental attack alone, just by having less resistance. Is not good. Plus, good. Plus, makes them more susceptible to effects like berserk. Makes them, you know, attack each other, or disabling abilities like throw net, stun, dazzled, whatever status effects. They can really mess with the orc army. You need to be very careful when fighting units, enemies with special abilities, because your guys are more vulnerable. Their range strength is lower. That's why their archer unit sucks. Sucks. Well, it's worse than the others. And why the special warlord unit, the mounted archer, is not so great in orc form. They have this incredibly useful ability to heal after each battle, which can add up if you fight if you have a good mobility, high mobility units, and can fight a lot of battles, easy battles per turn. Also, their barracks are cheaper. And so on, you can choose yourself. There are non mini races, that's how you do it. Okay, and each unit of the particular race, of course, will inherit this. Their cities produce more gold. Again, units are more susceptible to status effects and elemental damage. Again, need to pay attention. Was talking about classes and their hidden tech trees. I don't know if I can find anything here. The tech tree, they probably will have to go out of the game, sadly, to see particular tech tree for warlord, for the druid, archdruid, for dreadnought, because that's where the main differences between classes lies from. sadly it's not on this or even sadlier, I don't know where to find it. Leader, Heart of Empire, Heroes, yeah. Cities, pillar of the economy. You need cities to have resource and research mainly, but all the other resources, income, combat, we'll get to that. Resources, diplomacy. I went a bit to classes. I went a bit into units. I want a bit in expansion, research, city. Again, cities, need to click again, have these tabs here. It shows what buildings are already in place, already built in a particular city. You can sell them for some gold. These are some big options, actions you can take on the city. You can, I don't know, raise it to the ground or end your lose your game. The state you can release as a vassal, which means you lose direct control, but it still provides you some resources. You lose control on the building queue, and I don't think vassals actually ever build anything. This is the building tab. This is the buildings you can do. You can attempt to build each turn. This is the cost in resources. Like I said, most basic things only cost small amounts of gold. As you move on to more advanced buildings, it also costs mana, and you need to be careful. If you have, you may have something like looks very encouraging at particular like. I have 200 mana per turn income. Yeah, that's great. But you're trying to build, I don't know, five laboratories in five cities. That means the next turn you're gonna be down. All that mana will be down, 250 mana, just to pay for those laboratories. And you won't, probably won't even have enough mana to cast. In combat, even if your heroes will have the casting points, you will be out of mana. You need to be very aware at every moment what all your cities are building. So once you have a lot of cities, you can quickly check here what each city is building and how much at a glance, see how much gold and mana you're spending a particular turn just building buildings and units. Back to the city buildings. So here's buildings, here's units. There's great unit building tree you can find online. No, unit building tree, a city building tree you can find online. Sadly, again, the game doesn't show it like this. Laboratory enables observatory, and observatory enables whatever. This builder hall enables stone wall and siege workshop, and so on. Of course, with something, these are very familiar for very similar to all cities and all classes, but classes also get a special building, and also races get a special building that differs from each race and each class. So in this case, the warlord get gladiator pit, so that will get out, allow you to build after research, then it allow you to build their special units, their special class units. Racial building, it's the tier 3 unit building, which differs from race to race. Orcs can build shock troopers at tier 3. These guys, they're great. Other, the dwarves have firstborns, elves have, I believe, griffin riders, and so on. You can check them here very quickly, like This you can check in using this in game encyclopedia works. Come on, grind faster. Other these are the basic work units. All classes get access to them. Let's start by tier. The building unit, the settler, and this is the tier 3 unit, shock trooper. You get to see the stats here. If we move to draconians, we see that they have other basic units, and tier 3 it's very different from those shock troopers. The other ones are pretty similar, though at some points different. Like no other race has AoE damage tier 1 unit. Elves with their longbowmen and the support units and the tier 3 Gryphon Rider, which is a flyer. And of course, you can also check the class units. Orc Warlord. This is the units that will be enabled by building after researching the Warlord tech tree, and here. And then building the appropriate building level, warlord building in the city. The rest of the city tree is similar between all classes. Might not be making much sense here. That single image with the tech tree for all classes and races would have been worth 1,000 words. You can find it online. Google, I don't know, Age of Wonders city building tree or something like that. You should have it. It would make perfect sense. Like I said again, it's shrine enables temple, and this is available for all war class and race combos. And war hall enables guardhouse and riders hall and tier 3 race building, and so on and so on. This one enables both stone walls and siege workshops, and siege workshop enables masters and blah 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 blah. There's some prerequisites, and it's sad that you don't have the game doesn't show you the whole picture, just like it doesn't show you the tech tree. But again, these are resources you can find online. And again, specific to a city, it has a name. This indicator here is the Throne City. I think this helps with morale. So we're talking about city stats now. City stats is the amount of gold generated. Each city will generate a basic amount of gold depending on its development level. Villages will generate, again, this sadly is not shown in the game. There's a table you can find again online. It will show you villages will generate 10 gold income and 0 mana and 0 knowledge and I don't know, 25 hammers. If you manage to get the village to the next level, which it's I don't know, town, city, whatever, then the gold income, the base income will go up to 20 and the hammers will go up to 30 or to 45. I don't know them by heart, but you get the meaning. And also the base population growth. It's weird to see it like base income, but this is population growth. It's 20, 250, 25 hammers, No knowledge, no mana by default, and no gold by default, and 10 gold by default. Then there could be other sources like resource generator, like for mana, for gold, for production. We'll get into this a bit as I'll explore more of the map. Show other example of resource generators. Also, there's buildings that act as resource generators. The shrine will also produce mana and enables an even an extra resource generator. Temple storehouse helps population growth. Building house shows the production, increase the production. We'll get very soon into city production. And all those bonuses are generally additive, and on top of that, there is the city happiness multiplier, which multiplies the output. And on top of that, there's the ability to focus on merchandise and houses and mana output, and that is again multiplier. So if you have from various input, for example, you have 100 gold income, let's say you have a lot of mines, and you have a spell that gives 10 extra or empire upgrade that gives 10 extra gold per city, and you are paying as Tigrans that get extra 10 gold, and you have race governance bonuses, we'll get into those as well, that provide extra, one of these buildings to generate again extra gold. And you add all of that up, and it gives you 100 gold output, and you get a very happy modifier. I think the maximum is 50% output, so you get to multiply that by times 1.5. And then you ask the city to do merchandise. That is a further 1.5 multiplier. So it's 100. It's times 1.5 times 1.5. It's like 225 or something. My multiplication skills are rusty, but I think that's you get the meaning. It's double multiplication between happiness bonus and the production merchandise, housing, and or mana. It can really help enhance a particular city output. Say you have a city with a lot of mines, and you're desperate for some extra gold. If you crank up the happiness and use this produce merchandise, you can really increase the amount of gold you output. But this also only works if you have a high base. And like I said, it's not very easy to increase the base that much for a particular spot. The concept of again, we dance around with research and also with gold. And we manage the concept of tall city. There are just not that many resource generators around. So multiple cities is the way to go. What other stats are for city population? We went through it. There's some stages. The stages I can show here. Again, I think I showed them before. Population growth. No, just growth. City growth. Here are the stages required for growth, but it doesn't show how much gold and production it gets at the various stages. At Metropolis, I think it might be 40 gold or 50 gold, but here it's 10 gold. And the same for production. Obviously, you get a bit more once the city gets bigger. Another benefit of bigger city, you get more tiles. If the terrain is favorable, you'll get happiness. I think I touched on city happiness before. So overall, it has multiplier on. It acts as a multiplier on production, gold, mana, and population output. Sources for it, like I said, there's a base. There's the Empire happiness, which you can alter by winning battles and losing battles and getting heroes. Then there's particular race modifier, relation you have with a particular race. How they influence that? If you settle a ton of human cities, the humans will love you. If you burn a ton of human cities, the humans will hate you. That's how you work that relation, and it will affect the morale in the cities you control with that race. And also, there's local sources of happiness. There are happiness resources on the map. There's no one in view in this start, but there are. There's also buildings you can build that increase happiness. There's spells you can cast. I think the rogue has something called Iron Grip that's plus 300 happiness. And there's also the one generated by the terrain. And if you don't have it right, you don't have the right race for the particular terrain, you can always play with a bit of terraformation with spells. That's morale, that's the output. A little parenthesis about production. Production, it's a lie. It's not like in Civilization when you can buy a unit or building or produce it with hammers. There's no hammers. The hammers are a lie. You pay for everything in this game. And that's why having a big empire, let's say 20 cities, and trying to develop them at the same time, like I said, multiply the cost of the cheapest building with 20 and see the amount of resources you spend each time if you try to improve all your cities constantly. It's enormous amount of resources, and you're not gonna be able to afford it. Add to that the cost for the building units, which again, there's no economy that can support that. But what do those production units do? Well, they do have a purpose. They act as a limiter of sorts. Say you want to build this gladiator pit that costs 100 gold and 100 mana. In total, that is 200 production. The cost for it is gonna be taken at once, immediately. You put it here on the building queue. If you have the materials, it's gonna subtract 100 gold and 100 mana right away at the cost of the building. If you don't have enough, the building it will show here. Let's do it. I don't have enough mana, so I know I cannot queue this. It won't produce right now, so it showed not enough resources. But if I did, it would have subtracted 100 gold and 100 mana and started the production. Now, the amount of time it takes to actually get it out, that's where the production happens. The payment is the same, you know, I don't know, one hammer production city and one that has 500 production. You're not gonna see that in a game. I think I've seen most nearing 200 hammers. The limit for most of the game is gonna be the amount of gold and the amount of mana. You won't, even if if you have let's say you have seven cities each with 200 hammers, hypothetical example, that doesn't mean you'll be able to output seven tire four units per turn, because the hammers are not the cost. You won't have the economy to buy seven tire four units. You won't have the economy to buy two for a lot of time. You won't have the economy to buy a single one for a long time in the beginning of the game. That's what limits you. Not the hammers. The hammers are a lie. Unit cost and mana is the actual limiter to how many city improvements and army you can put out. Of course, if this number is too small, it can cause problems. Like I said, seven turns to get out of that gladiator pit, it's a bit much. During this time, it would be much preferable if you could get the gladiator pit out in say one turn, and the other six turns have the city produce merchandise and increase its gold output. So there are benefits to having high production, wasting time actually producing the unit, wasting less time. Ideally, you will want to produce everything in one or two turns. So then if you don't have enough resources to build more stuff in that city, at least the city is not wasting its time building something. It is free to increase its merchandise or housing or mana output. That's where the production helps. If you want a city that wants to spawn spam, I don't know, monster hunters, orc monster hunter, monster hunter, it will cost, come on, it will cost, it says here 100 production points. Actually, warlords get an empire technology that lowers cost for most units, so this will be a bit lower. But let's say it's 100. Ideally, you will want to have 100 production in that city, which is pretty hard to achieve. Or at the very least 50, so you get one every two turns. There is no concept of carryover sadly in this game. It's not that finely grained. So if you have, let's say you have 99 hammers, you will still take two turns and you're gonna waste air quotes 98 hammers each time you build one of those monster hunters. Same goes for research knowledge. If you have if you're researching was no this is cast spell, that's the research. If you're researching a spell that costs 80 knowledge and you are outputting 800 knowledge per turn, you still cannot research multiple technologies per turn, and you're gonna waste 720 of those knowledge points each turn. So ideally, as your knowledge increases, you'll want to get the cheap cost technologies out of the way, even though you would perhaps want to rush another tech faster, because otherwise later in the game you'll be wasting more and more knowledge clearing one turn technologies and wasting a lot of knowledge. It is the same system for knowledge and for production. Let's go back to the city. There are other stats. Now this is production, the global resources, the local resources, production, population, a few more buttons here, produce units, produce buildings, actions, absorb, plunder, blah blah blah. The morale of the city. If they're really, really unhappy, they might revolt, they might leave your empire. This is rash production, which means for a cost in happiness and extra cost in gold, you can finish production in one turn. This is a very tricky button, and usually, like, 99% of the time, early game, it's something not to be touched, because you will always, 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 always be constrained by the amount of gold and mana, not the, but the, by the production in your cities. So wasting extra gold on a unit or a production, actually, the math, it's it depends. If you have very poor production and huge gold generating, that's actually, it just occurred to me. Say you have two hammers. Again, not gonna happen. Even this poor city, by default, it has 25 base income, so you can't go lower than that. You have 25 hammers, and you want to build something that will take, as shown here, 7 turns. It could take more, and you would have 100 gold income base. If you let it drag out for 7 turns, you lose the gold you would have gained by building this rushing production for one turn, and then for 6 turns using the build merchandise multiplier on this presumably huge base. So you need to be careful, but again, early game, probably not worth it. In some cities with a huge gold on output base and underdeveloped production, maybe there's cases. Or, of course, there could be emergency situation, like you're trying to rush a couple of units for defense or timed attack, and then it would make sense, and you have a bit of resources surplus, you would do that. But most of the time, you need to really, 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 really think about pushing this button to rush production and wasting extra resources on making that go up faster. Okay, I'm going to do to pause the video a bit, and when I come back, I'm going to talk a bit about combat. I think I'm going to fight these guys to release this production, because I can grab it right away. In this particular example, playing the warlord and having this spell by chance available from the start of the game, it might, if you're unlucky, not only you don't have it already in your spellbook, but also it's not even in the visible technologies for research. I would have to first research some other spells before it would, the RNG would be kind enough to present it here, so I could research and then finally cast it. But like I said, if you are lucky enough and have it from the start, I could get this production resource right away next turn. If I clear, if I kill the defenders, I could get this. These mana things are not going anywhere. This is, I think, knowledge bonus, so I could use it to research a technology. This is very good. Good army. I don't like these guys much, but I'm going to talk about orc units when I actually start proper let's play with them. Now I'm just going to enter a bit on a battle, and yeah, of course it's defended. Because it's more valuable than these mana piles. And now, so I'm gonna send this guy there. Yeah, each on the strategic map, each unit can has its own movement points and can function at its own stack. It can move independently. And with this big army, big powerful army, I would move and do this battle. Here you see that not all units have the same amount of movement points. Depending on their skills, they navigate terrain at different speeds. So during regular gameplay, then especially because they're different type of units, you're not gonna have the same amount of movement points. This guy, for example, has a surplus, so I can use him to attack here and only consume some of his movement points. Anyway, he's got an excess compared to the others, so this way I get to move perhaps one, two tiles further each turn. Yeah, with this sort of micromanagement. Anyway, I'm going to take a short break, which is gonna be invisible for the recording, and when I come back, I'm going to demonstrate to talk a bit about combat, which is a big bonus of this game. And actually, just to illustrate combat a little better, yes, I can bring that guy here. And I'm also gonna do this. Be right back. So again, just something I'd like to add about city production. Having some production, a decent production. For a city, it's ideal, is because you want a city to spend as much time as possible building building upgrades. Of course, a production a unit production city will be production producing units. That's its purpose. But the other cities, you want to get them as fast as possible from the undesired, unoptimal status of wasting their time building these support buildings, and get them in the best optimal state of building, maximizing gold output or mana output. So that's why having a good production income, it's useful. The sooner you get to the city to maximize its gold output, the better. And the more cities in your empire you have at building gold, the more army it will allow you to field a bigger army. Okay, let's go for the battle. So I can attack here with any unit. Like I said, ideally would be with the one with the highest movement points left. I haven't touched good and evil alignment. Certain actions in game can shift your alignment from neutral, which you are a start to game, towards bad. evil and or good. Just a sec. Okay, I want to go over all the benefits of being evil or good, because I just don't know them all by the top of my head. I'll just say that there are benefits. For example, there are units dedicated to good or dedicated to neutral, dedicated to evil, good. And if you're if you have very good alignment and you recruit, you field attempt to field the units dedicated to evil, they will have maximally terrible morale, and they will fumble their attacks like 40% of the time. They'll not be very effective. There are other effects, Festival of Good Blight, of good, that gives extra resistance to units dedicated to good, and extra damage versus undead and units dedicated to evil, and so on and so on. There are various bonuses, and the way you can shift your alignment, this is one of them. Outnumbering enemies by a huge margin, so to force them to try and flee. So this is a quick way to amass evil or good points alignment. There's also migrating population in a city is an evil act. Raising city is an evil act. Declaring war is an evil act. Liberating city as a vassal probably is a good act. Absorbing cities into your empire might be good act. Whatever, you learn, and usually they are signaled like this, and the choices are pretty clearly signaled. It's not like, why am I evil now? What did I do? It's clearly signaled. Let him run. We want to be good. Which means I'm gonna go here. If the army can make it, though. Not enough of the army can make it. Yeah, those guys are no joke. Could do something like this. But still, only these guys can make it all the way here. And I still don't have enough movement points to attack. To rush or not to rush? That's basically all my goal, just to get this done next turn, so then I can't start working on storehouse or something else if I don't get more money, because there won't be any money to afford building this, purchasing this new building. So I'll be down to switching to merchandise, but because the base output of this small starting city is not that great, you just add a small amount of extra gold, 12 gold. I won't be able to recuperate 150 gold by getting 12 extra gold 3 turns. So I think in this instance it pays for me to just let it be, let it slowly happen by itself. It's a bad situation, though. It's not that bad. was thinking maybe you cannot flank, attack this dude with multiple stacks, but you can. You just tedious to and will lose a lot of movement points to get them in a position to flank on top of the mountains. Perhaps if you have some flyers. Yeah, another thing to keep in mind, in this particular situation, I'm going to get some extra production anyway next turn because of this spell. So we're gonna cast this spell on this city, the border will expand. We've cleared this, it now adds to the city's production. So, Magma Forge 20 and the happiness works on a bigger base, which means I already gain a turn here. I could rush now for 50 gold, and that might be a better option, way more viable than rushing next turn was. But I think I won't do it. No. Let's go into illustrating some battle. What it's all about. So, see, this is the maximum amount of stacks available in a battle. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, like I said. Of course, during the battle you can summon more units. Summoning can are strategic summoning. You summon units in your domain or near the heroes, and then you spend mana each turn sustaining that summoned creature. And that will be a summoned creature vulnerable to various spells or bonuses versus summoned creatures. Or you can summon units usually temporarily during combat. Those are different summoning spells. Option to rethink your options. Now you can always press that button, nothing happened. You just abort the attack, manual combat, auto combat. This is on by default for multiplayer, so you kind of need to know, predict what the auto combat will do in a certain situation, how it will always kill your low HP, manage to suicide your low HP units, for example. You need to be wary of that. You need to heal it before the battle, or just take it out of the battle. And you can see you can gang up one stack with up to six stacks. Usually it's not gonna be like this. It's gonna be probably end game throne defense. Maybe you'll fight 3 versus 4, something like that. It's very nice. City sieges are can offer some pretty epic, epic battle feeling, fielding tons of units. And this is the battle grid. Defender gets to act first. Sometimes they'll the AI will just wait for you, sometimes they'll come. You can check during battle the abilities for each enemy unit. So in this case we have we're dealing with some very strange creatures, magical origin. So again, these are count somewhat similar to summoned. There are spells that heal specifically magical origin units. also spells that do damage to this type of units, extra damage. There are incorporeal, which adds pass well ability, which is very nice during city sieges. Huge physical damage protection, which is pretty much all my poor works are bringing. I don't think I have anything else. Yeah, there's no damage spell here, so it's gonna be tough to. They're gonna be very, very tough to get through. Wisp, phase, and also they have something very dangerous to my orcs, to my low resistance orcs. The static shield. Each time you attack them, 5 damage. 5 damage is not that much for beefy orcs, but stunning it leaves you unable to take any action and to take extra damage. Basically, all their attacks count as flanked. These guys don't have that issue, right? They're just they can inflict shocking. Lose mobility and take extra damage from shocking, but it doesn't disable you, just a debuff. So probably I would want to attack these guys first, and it will take a lot of attacks just to disable them. Now, in combat, movement. This unit has 36 move points. Do I have okay, these guys, they have 28 move points and they can move 4 tiles, which means the cost to move one per tile is 7. I think it's written someplace. I could always just move them one tile and see how much it took. It's 6. It's 6 movement points per tile. So, and according to the amount of move points per unit, it governs how much you can actually move in combat without spending an action point. At the start of each turn, you get 3 action points maximum, and they are colored. They are correlated with move. It's a strange system that works. If you don't move at all, if the unit doesn't move at all, or it moves in this green circle, which could be wider if you had a unit that can move, has more move points in combat. Usually, Tigrans, they can move faster, further in combat, and flying units. You could get for heroes flying mounts, and you can have the green circle expand to 2 tiles, and these ones go further and further. There's also the sprint ability, which is very strong. Basically, if you the green tile means how further you can move without consuming action points. If I move this great sword further here, I already consumed one action point. I still have 2. From here I could melee attack up to 3 times, but I already consumed an action point, so I can melee attack 2 times if I had a viable target in range. I don't. And this is the maximum of my movement. I cannot move any further this turn. And the action I can take, it could be one attack swing, melee, these guys don't have ranged, or I could trigger this uselessly because it would expire with it takes one until the end of the turn, or I could defend. It's called guard in this game. Guarding increases the defensive attributes, defense and resistance by 20%. You can compare with if I had another swordsman in here. Do you have, or we can check again with the swordsman at the start of the turn when the guarding it's off, and see the this attributes down by 20%. I'm gonna move closer. Moving closer is not ideal in this situation. That means these guys are gonna have an easier time getting multiple attacks on my guys, even if my guys are gonna be guarding. I am basing this on apparent overwhelming number of the force disparity here. But look, here we can play, I think, with sprint. So sprint adds 12 move points. So instead of 20, I'll have 40, and this should change the size of the rings, right? Yeah, it doesn't change the green one. It's still this, but I can go further and still have two actions left. Of course, I wasted the sprint. I don't want to get too close to that guy. And this is a pretty suicidal action, because now they're not guarding, they're subjected to flanking. Units that are not guarding at the end of the turn can only threaten the three tiles in front of them of what they're facing. No, they don't threaten anything, and they're subject to flanking attacks. Attacks from behind will deal extra damage, will force them to return and try to retaliate. Again, the hero, I could take this shot, you can see. It has medium range and straight shot with line of sight penalty. Straight shot means I can't take advantage of cover. Certain that's what it means. If I try to shoot and there's a unit in between or cover, I'm going to get that penalty as well. And it does less damage at long range. That's 50% range penalty. Long range means anything past three tiles, it's low range for this guy. Now again, he is way tougher. 50 HP and 12 defense. Excuse me, then these guys, so they'll probably get hit pretty badly, maybe even killed. So might as well do this very ineffective attack at out of optimal range and versus defended shielded enemies. But I'm pretty certain they won't go for the hero, they'll go for these poor guys, which I've left exposed with absolutely no good reason. If you end turn and your units haven't used all their actions, like these guys moving and attacking, they will automatically guard and be unflankable and harder to hit. There are units that can stop a unit guarding, like this elite tier 3 units. There are a few. They're not a lot. And thus reduce the attribute bonuses granted by defending and also allow the that unit to be flanked. Also, there was the option to cast spells. So as predicted, they will kill this guy, those guys, just because I set them up to be killed. Now, shock troopers, surprisingly, they don't have war cry, like most of the other worker units. From the beginning, they do gain it later. It's, I believe, at veteran promotion. They learn to war cry. It's surprising, but probably just a balancing issue, just for them not being too strong. Now these guys attack, that means they can be flanked, and from this yellow position I can hit twice. Only one of the attacks will have the flanking modifier, because they will turn after the first swing. They will switch to face my shock troopers. Damage previews show how much damage will be inflicted. The damage formula for melee attacks, physical damage, it's pretty simple. It's unit attack. You can find it, I think, even on the F1. Even on the encyclopedia, you take this damage type, you add all the other modifiers like overwhelm and flanking. In that case, flanking is +2, overwhelm is +3, I think. Let's check. You won't say about flanking, but overwhelm should be listed here. 3 damage, I think, yeah, against pikemen and shielded units. So that's 22. You take that 22, and it has you add 10 to it, base 10, that's 32. Then you multiply by an interval, it varies, ±20% randomly. So minimum it could be times 0.8, or maximum times 1.2. Then it could be fumbled, that's guaranteed, times 0.8. There's no RNG on fumbles. And there's an extra times 0.7, I think. It really do very low amount of damage on fumble attacks. If it were a crit, it removes the RNG, it's times 1.2, and then another times 1.3, that's the crit multiplier. Sadly, it's hard to see here. Oh, and also you subtract the target's defense. In this case, these guys have 9 defense. If they weren't flanked and they were defending, then the shield adds extra defense when you're not flanked. So defense would have been up to 11. And if they were guarding, then there'd be 11 times 1.2, a lot higher. And you subtract that before those multiplications from that 32 number. And then there's the physical protection, that's 16. Percent reduction, then you should get this 8 to 12 damage range. Anyway, I'm gonna swing those 2 attacks, and they manage to retaliate once. First time they turned around after the first attack, and after the second attack they retaliated. That consumed one of their action points. Retaliations consume a unit action points during its turn. Yeah, if I attack it more, I can consume all its action points, so next turn it won't act at all, it won't guard, it won't do anything. I I have the option to with these guys, however. I am in a position to flank these guys because their turnaround, they killed the poor spearmen. I could move there with no repercussion. This unit is threatening these tiles, it shows. If I were to move there, I would get punished with attacks of opportunity that also consume action points, unless your unit is tireless. Again, these guys are very, very powerful. Yes, my shock resistance is lowered because these guys shocked me, and they also do shock damage in melee. Yes, that's not cool. So the option for the great sword is to do 3 attacks here with 2 retaliations, or to move and finish those guys off. I think I'm gonna do 3 attacks here. I'm gonna activate Warcry to increase my damage. Again, now it shows the modifiers to my damage. If I would try to calculate it, 16 damage. I'm not certain. I should have checked before this, but we can check differently. F1 Orc Great Sword, if you it includes, so yes, so usually these guys start with 13 damage. Activating Warcry, it puts the Warcry damage here, but the flanking and the overhelm bonus, it doesn't show. So 13 plus 3 from Orkway, plus 3 for overwhelm, and plus 2 from flanking. If there were a bonus from the leader, this guy can add an extra 1 point of attack. This would have been even higher. Then you subtract their defense, which in this case is 9. Like I said, because the shield doesn't matter for flank attack, but this will only matter for the first attack, because they will turn to face me, and then they will have the shield. So the damage here, illustrating, it's actually lying. Only the first attack will have the chance to do 8-11, the second two will do less damage. Of course, if I were to attack the wisp have a static shield, so after each attack I run the risk of being stunned, and all my attacks will stop, will be cancelled. Let's just do this. Okay, 3 attacks. Overwhelm and Warcry applied for all 3 swings, but the flanking bonus only for the first one. Now these guys are in position to finish those guys off, I think. Impaler, no. Impaler only has 1 action point. What happened here? Excuse me. What consumed his actions? Maybe attack of opportunity last turn, or I was attacked, because there's some HP missing. I haven't paid attention, but this is going to be only one swing. And see, for the first swing, these guys waste time just turning around. Moving the horses away. Oh, the pixies attacked the impalers. That's what happened. So the pixie is facing this way. It's threatening this bear. I could move away. Could attract it times. So, in theory, I would have enough damage to kill it, but there's also that that high chance to stun. It's probably gonna happen, see? After the first attack, he got stunned. You need to be very careful against these type of enemies early on. Ideally, you would use ranged attacks from support units and archers to deal with them. Heroes, the type of heroes I have now don't have multiple ranged attack per turn. This is one shot every 2 turns, and this one is one shot per turn, one swing per turn. It's not ideal. You wouldn't deal the damage needed. These guys are very tough for. I think the Phantom Warriors do more damage. Sadly, I won't be able to kill it unless I roll. No. Won't be able to kill it. It says 6-8, but that's only for the first swing. Then it will turn, and the damage will go much lower. I will lose the flanking modifier. Its armor will go up because they'll have shields, so I can't really kill it. But I'm going to attempt. That was an attack of opportunity. I run through this guy's threaten area. It was indicated here. And that's it. I'm out of actions. If this Phantom Warrior moves to and attacks the hero here, and these guys attack 3 times, they might kill it. These guys don't have. They don't do a lot of damage. Hopefully. But it's multiple times, so. And each of their attacks will have a flanking bonus, so that will be +2 to each of these 3 times. It might seriously injure this guy, and this Phantom Warrior, he does way more damage, but he probably won't survive if he tries to leave there because he's threatened by these guys. Yeah, he had some action points consumed by the bear attacking him earlier, and him retaliating, I think. Or did I just get stunned by its passive shield? There is a combat log here, and it tells us what the wisp did. Yeah, only 2 actions. Good. Goodbye. Goodbye, and that was a terribly fought battle. But those are some of the basic concepts, and this was a useless sacrifice, unneeded. And that's I've gotten some research which gets spent. Immediately, it researched my skill, and it moves on the Warlord, the tech tree. That's the next option after raise militia. There's produce Berserker that then unlocks produce Monster Hunter and so on. Probably not the best illustration of combat mechanics ever seen on this game, but it should do. There's tricks you can do with against the enemies that have extremely high damage, and you don't have any unit that can survive 3 swings for that melee unit. From that melee unit, what we can overwhelm it with multiple low level units. If you have enough damage, you can just keep flanking, attacking it from different directions, doing one attack per turn. And what this will do, it will each time just make the targeted unit turn to face its attacker and not retaliate. But this is only viable if you want to you have enough damage to kill that unit next turn, because otherwise at the end of the turn it will still have its three actions and it will kill something. What can be done is to actually let that particular unit retaliate, but only once against each unit, and you can control that by moving a unit slightly away and then moving to attack once or twice, depending on how that target unit is facing, so that each unit you attack with only it's a retaliation. And if the targeted unit doesn't have tireless, this way you consume all its action points for next turn, and you've managed to split the damage it does. Instead of concentrating its three attacks on one unit and killing it, you've managed to hopefully split its damage in to three units that will all each be injured, but all will hopefully survive at the end of the combat. I'm going to illustrate a lot of combat, hopefully with the skill required to win most of the encounters without losses. In the actual let's play I have planned for this Warlord. There's probably things I haven't touched upon, but I think this video's been overly long as it is, and I'm the things I've missed on, I'm probably going to touch on the actual let's play. So, thank you for watching. Goodbye.